Thanks. So I'm Neil Mitchell. I work at Standard Chartered Bank. And this talk is very much on the title, Splitting Things Together in Haskell. So if you work on any reasonably sized project, and you know, the one I work on is in a bank, it's a library for the quant group, but any reasonable sized project, say interest or something like that, you'll usually have a bunch of code that is what you spend all your time developing. And this will be elegantly designed. You'll have used the latest and greatest type systems, you've come up with a nice DSL, it'll be whizzy stuff that you've really polished it. This is what you work on all day. And then every week, every month, every day, you'll make a release that you give to people who just want to use the end product you're producing. So you'll make a release and you'll thoroughly test it, and this will be a shining bastion of how great your project is. And people spend a lot of time thinking about this bit up here and this bit up down here. But they don't spend nearly as much time thinking about how you go from your code to a release and all the bits in between. And so when I started working in a bank, I didn't think about that either. But I found actually the bits in between, unless you get them right, none of your code works. You can't really produce the code that you want to, and it just doesn't all fit together. So this talk is about how we can use Haskell as the glue language. And so what kind of things am I thinking of when I say the glue? Well, so the most obvious example is the build system. The build system takes your source code and actually produces executables that your users can run. But there's more than just that. You've also got things like the test harness, so the thing, not your tests themselves, but the things that run all your tests in sequence, in parallel, and tell you whether they're working or not. You've got the continuous integration. I hope everyone is nowadays using some form of continuous integration. So this will build your code and test it and keeps the quality up. You've got a bundle into the release, so you've got to collect all these exes, maybe some README files, put them all together. You've got to build some installer, so a Debian package, a Windows installer, a tarball that you can distribute to people. And then you've got to actually put it on some servers. So there's a lot of stuff that goes on between the code and the release that people don't tend to think about. So while you describe your code as elegantly designed, or hopefully you aim for that, and your release is thoroughly tested, how would people tend to describe this stuff, this glue in the middle? Any thoughts?
Messy,
yeah.
Sticky back plastic.
So one term someone used when they were talking to me recently was a rat's nest of bash. Typically, this is written in bash for reasons that I don't really understand. So would your team write a 10,000 line bash file? So I've worked in two teams that have, and they were both teams of functional programmers. So if we're doing this, surely everyone else is either doing worse, or I just called bad teams. So the GHC developers, the main Haskell compiler, they have 10,000 lines of Makefiles, which is just shell scripts, really. So anyone else want to confess to having fallen down this hole, or their teams having fallen down this hole? Yeah, a few hands and a few people pretending not. Well, yeah, it's not always bash. So on the YHC project I was working on, we fell down this hole with Python, but it was still the same flavor of code. So what do we do? Well, we can accept regular failures. So our releases fail to build every other day. Our tests don't always run because of test failures. They just fall over. We can invest lots of time and money on an ongoing basis. So continually spend a lot of time for someone to sit there and babysit these fragile systems. And my experience in banking is that actually most people opt to do the first of these, both of the first of these two. It rarely works, and it was an expensive way of failing. But the way I'd like to suggest is we should do it right. And we know how to do software right, because we're doing it to make our normal code. We just need to apply the same lines to the glue. So for the last 5 years, I've been working on a number of projects that have helped to improve the infrastructure.
And out of that, we've spun three open source libraries. So unlike some of the other stuff in this track so far, you can actually take these, they're on GitHub, they're released on Hackage, and you can use them in your systems today. So this talk, I'm going to hope to sell these three things, as well as the idea of using Haskell or some other real language for your Glue code. So the three things I'm going to talk about are Shape, a build system, NSIS, something for generating Windows installers, and Bake, a continuous integration system. Has anyone heard of any of these before? And which ones? Yeah, okay, so Shake and Bake. Okay, so Shake is a build system. So if you're describing this to your manager, it's an alternative to Make or Ant or Scones or WAF or something like that. And the idea is that it's reliable and robust. And I both mean the build system is reliable and robust, and the build systems that you write using it are also, hopefully, mostly reliable and robust. Has a very powerful set of dependency description features, so you can hopefully describe your problem in a natural way. This is grungy code, so anything that helps you kind of use the words and phrases you're happy with and model your problem accurately hopefully makes a difference. And it's also very fast to run, so you don't have to spend a long time waiting for compilation, hopefully. So this is a developer conference, so let's kind of bring that down to concretely, how does Shape work? How does that work for developers? So Shape isn't really a build tool. It's a Haskell library using which you can write a Haskell program using features of this library that is a build system. So you write your own build system using Shape, but you're in control, and you can pull in the bits you want from Shape. So your code is in Haskell, but most of the time, you're going to be calling out to compilers and stuff, system commands basically. So this is something, you know, calling system commands a lot. This, for some reason, people often go straight to Bash. Go straight to Haskell, works just as well. There are two particular dependency features that Shape has that I'll go into in a little bit more depth. Monadic dependencies, which basically means that you can deal with generated code properly, and polymorphic dependencies, which basically means your dependencies don't just have to be files on disk. And I'll go through those two in a bit more depth. But just because we're writing it in this high-level language doesn't mean we don't want to go to optimize it and test it. And in particular, Ninja, which is kind of the gold standard for fast build systems, it's what the Chrome project uses, Shape can interpret Ninja build files, and Shape can build Ninja, the program, using Ninja's own build rules faster than Ninja can do it. So, and that's actually part of my continuous integration test. If it goes slower, I actually can't push kind of Shape. And it's a GitHub project, of course. Everything's a GitHub project nowadays. So let's go through a kind of simple hello world example of a build system. So imagine we've got a file result.lst, which just lists a bunch of file names. So for this presentation, I've got three files, and I want to put them in a tar file. So we're going to go from this file listing some files to a tar file, which has the contents of those files inside it. So Seth, this was a Haskell program, and yeah, indeed it is. The first line is an import statement. And you import the Shape library to get access to all these Shape facilities. We define our main, because it is our main, and we can do whatever we like with it, as main equals Shape args, Shape options. And Shape args basically means let Shape take care of command line argument processing for you. And if you run this program, you get a superset of the make command line. Basically, all the flags that make supports, Shape will support, and then there are some more. So you can get a quite powerful program just by asking Shape to do it for you. This is the actual build rules. So you want result.tar. After I've finished running, I would like result.tar to be on the disk. That is the job of the build system, to create result.tar. How do we create result.tar? Well, we define a rule. So to build any tar file, we do this sequence of actions. And this sequence of actions says, well, the first thing we're going to do is look at our list file. So we need our list file. We have a dependency on the list file. And this syntax just means take the word result.tar and replace the extension with lst. And this is just a normal Haskell function defined in a file path library. So we can just reuse things like file path manipulation straight from standard Haskell. Do interrupt me if I'm losing anyone. Next, we read the file, the list file, into the variable contents. And we need the files listed by contents. So what we've done is we've said, read the list file, then make sure each of the files in the list file exists and has been built. And then we call tar at the end. So just tar minus cr, just box standard tar. And we've used a little bit of Haskell's syntactic sugar to make this look not terribly unpleasant with a list of words or anything. And this will build result.tar. It's certainly more wordly than make. There's a lot more syntactic overhead than make. But hopefully we'll kind of make up for that with the additional power. So what does shake provide us that something like make doesn't? Well, the biggest answer is monadic dependencies. So let's imagine we've got the situation here on the right. We have checked in a file foo.xml that describes some metadata. Maybe it's an RPC convention. Maybe it's the schema of an XML document. Maybe it's the users in our organization. Whatever. It's metadata style stuff. We run a generator over that, and we generate a file foo.cpp. So this is the metadata transform. Maybe you've made a fast hash mapping, a perfect hash of it, something like that. Then we compile foo.cpp to foo.log, just using the standard compiler. So the question is, what are the dependencies of foo.cpp? And in essence, in foo.log in particular, in essence, that's the same as asking, what files does foo.cpp hash include? So that's it's a very simple problem to get your head around. But in normal build systems, so essentially shake, scones, and redo are monadic, and everything else is implicative. And in an implicative build system, you have to tell me the dependencies before you start doing anything. So before I start running this generator, I have to say what foo.obj depends on. And it makes you do that with the code. So foo.obj colon the list of dependencies. And that list of dependencies, what do you write there? Well, it's very hard to tell. So in make, there are two standard solutions. You can run your build in phases. So you can generate this in one phase, one call to make. Then separately, start again, and do this in another call to make. And then you can look at foo.cpp to find out what it includes. The other thing you can do is, from foo.xml, you can guess what hash include statements might end up in foo.cpp. Both of these have many problems when you're trying to scale up. In a monadic build system, you can always add new dependencies later, so you just generate foo.cpp, and look at it, and that tells you what it includes. So it's a very simple answer, but it's fundamentally more powerful than you can encode in something like make. And if you look back one slide, you'll see here, we looked at the file, the list file, to see what it included, and then we depended on each of the files it included. And that's much more powerful than we can do in something like make, trivially. The other thing is polymorphic dependencies. So often in a build system, the compiler version that is on your path will be a dependency. So if you've got GCC 4.5 on your path and you build your project, and then you change your path, so GCC 4.6 is on your path, well actually all the C files you compiled have an implicit dependency on the version of GCC that's on your path. So using polymorphic dependencies, you can say that the version of GCC on your path
is something you are actively dependent on. And then you can just change your path, run your compiler, and all the C files will rebuild, but for example, all your documentation or your Haskell won't rebuild. So that's very nice. It's not nearly as important as the monadic dependencies, but it's useful for getting the kind of 100% perfect build system that your users never have to think about. Because all of this is trying to say, well, previously we had a problem and we shared its difficulty with the user and with the author of the infrastructure. Now we're taking all the complexity to the infrastructure and hopefully making the user's job a bit easier. So this is a quote from Stefan Kirsten, who is at SoundCloud. So they do cross-platform music stuff in C and maybe Haskell. I'm not actually sure if they use Haskell in their product. But they've been using Shake for the last 2 years, and they've had a great time. And in particular, I found out about this quite recently. So for almost 2 years, they were using it without having ever talked to the author of Shake. I think it's a good sign of an open source project. If you know all your users, you're not really there yet. So yeah, they enjoy it. We've been using it at Standard Chartered for almost 6 years now. At the beginning, before we came up with Shake, we had 10,000 lines of Makefile. We're a team of elite functional programmers with 10,000 lines of Makefiles. That's just embarrassing. After converting to Shake, doing the exact same job, producing the exact same files in the exact same places, we had less than 1,000 lines of Shake. And our code compiled more than twice as fast. So literally, you type Make, you wait 20 minutes. You type Shake, you wait 10 minutes. Good code. It also became a lot more malleable. So originally, to modify our build system, you needed to know about everything in our build system, because it was very phase-driven, and each part relied critically on the phase's previous parts role. So only one person knew everything, and they were pretty much the only person who could touch the build system. With monadic dependencies, you just kind of describe, well, I need this now, I need this now. And the build system kind of sorts it all together in the right way. So it seems to be, you know, anecdotally, it seems to be a much more composable way of writing a build system. And the nice thing is, 5 years ago, we wrote the build system, and we still have roughly the same build system. Most of the rules haven't changed, a few bits and pieces on the added to it, but yeah, we haven't needed to go back for a complete rewrite. Whereas our main system, even in the 4 months it existed, I think we rewrote it twice. So this is partly to sell Shake to you, but it's also to sell Haskell, and in fact, any reasonable language to you. And a lot of what Shake gives you isn't Shake giving you anything, it's just stealing from Haskell. So Haskell does reasonable DSLs. They're not as nice as your own custom syntax, like Make has, but they're reasonable. I use the type system a little bit, but basically you're calling out system commands. So pretty much free-for-all strings in files are not much type that bit, but not much. What Shake really thrives on is the abstraction. So I've worked on several projects with 10,000 lines of Makefiles. None of them share any of their Makefile with anything else on the planet. In fact, I'm not really aware of anyone who shares Makefiles, reusable pieces of Makefile, because Make it just isn't that flexible. Whereas as soon as you've got Shake, there are already 7 packages on package which supply pre-built Shake rules. So if you're building canvas lava files for a Xilinx FPGA, there's a set of rules to do that already, which you have to instantiate somewhere. There are 2 packages for doing it for C. One of them will target pNACL, iOS, Android, Mac, GCC, Visual Studio. So it's already, we're seeing that we can start to abstract over things just because we're working in a language that actually has abstraction. And you can profile. So the other advantage of moving to a real language is before you had kind of C on one side and Bash on the other, so there's no really good place to put useful stuff that you dreamt up one night at 2 in the morning. With Haskell, it's much easier just to hack in a new feature just because you feel like it. And in particular, this is one I quite like. So this is the taskbar while I'm doing a Shake build. In particular, it's told me there are 3 minutes, 12 seconds to go in this build,
and I am 82% complete. And developers can use this to decide whether to go to have a coffee, go out for lunch, or go home for the day. And it's quite a valuable feature. Obviously, it's only a prediction, but they tend to be roughly-ish, right? Okay, so that's Shake. If anyone has any questions on Shake, quick question on Shake before we...
Just a quick one, I'm not very familiar with Haskell, but Gradle, which is a sort of build system that's increasingly popular, has the notion that build stages and inputs and outputs for a set of inputs, if they haven't changed since the last build, doesn't bother people building the output again. That sounds like a sort of procedural way of doing the same sort of thing. What's monadic about this? Is it that just because you mentioned things, aren't they? Have they been captured by the monad machinery?
With the applicative, you've got inputs go to outputs, and then you've got actions. With the monadic, you've got inputs have actions, and those actions themselves can say, you say the outputs, you say the actions, but at any point the actions can say, oh, I need another input now. And in particular, they can look at some of their inputs, the actual values of some of their inputs, and then decide they need more inputs. So that's the difference. Okay? So, moving on to NSIS, the installer generator. So who's heard of NSIS? So you've almost all certainly installed something using NSIS if you ever install things with Windows. So this predates me by a long way. So it was originally the Winamp installer. It goes back far enough that the internet pages that would tell me how old it is no longer exist. This is what it kind of looks like. It generates really nice, small, fast-running Windows installers. So the kind of things you want to give to your users, and your users will have a good experience. The problem is that you have to write a script to tell NSIS how it should build your installer and what your installer should do. And that is a painful, terrible experience. So essentially, this script has two kind of elements in it. The first is the structure. You say which pages you'd like to show your installer, how, you know, do you want to show a license confirmation dialog, do you want to select components, which components do you want to select, all that kind of thing. And the second is the actions which actually run when your user said, you know, hits the install button, installs some files, puts some stuff in the registry. The problem with NSIS is that both of these parts have serious issues. So as a computer scientist, the one that freaks me out most is the programming language they've chosen. So essentially, it's assembly, but where all your registers are what are kilobyte words. So strings. So you script it with a programming language, but this programming language doesn't declare local variables, scopes, and all the rest. It has 20 registers, and they are named $0 through $9 and $R0 through $R9. It has goto. It doesn't have block scoping. Your if statement has to say what the labels it jumps to if it's true and if it's false. You can't write a block. You have a stack, but it doesn't work the way you think. Memory doesn't work the way you think. The functions, they don't pass registers. They're pretty much just a jump to a return address. And when I say everything is a string, it has to be a less than 1 kilobyte string. A 1 kilobyte string will segfault your installer. So there's all kinds of mess on this. The other problem is that it's got a really bad structure. So NSIS, a very early attempt at an installer, looks like Windows 95 by default. If you want it to look nice, like the installer experience you want to give your users, you have to use something called MUI2, which is basically pre-process and defines over NSIS. So you've got to work at two different levels of abstraction. In particular, if you get the level of abstraction wrong, it'll probably still work. It might skip a few pages in your installer, and it will look like Windows 95 has come back. So this is about language. What do? We just define a Haskell DSL over the top. Someone has defined a bad programming language, rewrite a good programming language and a compiler, and treat their programming language as a target for our programming language. And the nice thing is we get to reuse all the existing clever, nice user installer, but we get to do the bit we interact with better.
Sorry, is there any reason why you didn't use Wix?
I looked at a few. So Wix, I believe, is more declarative. It generates MSIs.
Well, yeah, but also it's all ins and outs of, like, just from the trying to build the whatever is going to build the thing. It also looks kind of nice, but it is interesting to make work, but it's less painful than that.
Yes, this is particularly bad for the developer, but particularly good for the user. So Wix generates MSIs. If you have a particular, I believe so, if you have a particular restriction, we had a particular restriction, we couldn't use MSIs, some internal policies meant that they got downloaded on an encrypted partition, and you can't install an MSI from an encrypted partition for some ridiculous reason. So we went with NSIS, we did look into it. It's also more declarative, and we wanted kind of more imperative, we wanted kind of very custom actions. But we could, I think Wix probably would work for some. So despite being a functional language, Haskell, we've written a very imperative expression, statement-orientated language on top of it. So even if you don't want to install it, this is quite nice for how you can do kind of an assembler in Haskell. So just to kind of compare NSIS and NSIS wrapped in Haskell, this is how you would write the test that you don't want your user installing into either the Windows directory or the system directory, because both of those things are probably a bad idea for installing a program. So we've got these strcomp, which is our kind of if with string comparison. And if these two things are the same, you jump to the first label, otherwise you jump to the second label. So if these two things are equal, go to bad. If these two things are equal, go to bad. Otherwise, go skip, skip over, and display a message box. So it's very kind of, feels like assembly programming. Whereas in the Haskell variant, you write this. So if these two things are equal, or these two things are equal, alert this. So it's much more expression statement language. Looking at the other side, so that's very much the code. This is moving more to the structure. So in NSIS, you have to write this to get a nice looking installer. And in particular, we want to insert the directory page, so we need to include the MUI2. So this exclamation mark is basically hash. I'm not sure if they hadn't heard of hash or something. And then we have to insert a macro, which I think is actually defining a new macro, which then something down, you know, in the aftermath will interpret as something. It's very weird. And if I misspell this, I think you'll just skip that page. It's quite horrible. If you compare it to this, this is the Haskell. And slightly ironically, this is also what the original NSIS looked like. So using Haskell, we basically managed to recreate the original experience. And it's all nicely statically typed and name checks and everything. So how do we go from something, how do we build up this kind of imperative language in Haskell? And this is one way to do it. This is the way we do it. So we can say that essentially when we're writing an NSIS program, what we're doing is accumulating NSIS assembly instructions. So we have some state at the top, which is a unique number, so a way of generating fresh labels, and a list of instructions in our program. An action. So this line is essentially just a state monad containing this state. And you can think of this as our statement kind of thing. A value in this language has a phantom type, which says what type it is. So in NSIS, everything's a 1K string, whereas we'd like to have ints and bools and strings. So we can use phantom typing to put them in at the top on our level. And then we can say that an expression is just an action that returns a value. So now we've built up a very imperative programming language. In particular, because expressions are actions returning values, expressions can have side effects. But that's okay, Haskell lets us track this. Maybe an imperative language is okay for a little installer. And we just overload the hell out of this. So there are, where should I go? There's a num instance for xbint, so you can write numeric literals and they become these expressions in this language. You've got a monoid for the string, so you can append to expressions with the normal stuff. You've got bits, so you can kind of do bit masking on your ints. So using Haskell, we can get quite a nice quite a real level DSL by doing this kind of deep embedding stuff that Leonard Augustin is famous for. The other nice thing is, once we're working in Haskell, we can build things up in layers. So I showed you before the if underscore. So that's not something built into our language. It's something we can define on top. And essentially, we can create some labels, do a test, grab the value of the test, and emit a strcomp-s instruction. So we're emitting the same instructions that NSIS uses. And we say that anything that is not literal empty string is in fact a false, is a true. Lay out the labels, lay out our true code from above, and lay out the other. So this is a very nice example of how we can define some primitives in Haskell, so go-tos, labels, and then we can build structured programming on top. And I think this would be a very nice way to teach beginners compiler course, without having to go as far as Lexham and stuff. Of course, now we've got Haskell, we might as well optimize this program. So in particular, if you ever see the occurrence of go to foo, and then the next instruction is foo, then the go to is completely redundant. And we can write this in Haskell as simply as this. So if we have a go to, then a label, and then the same label, we can just drop the go to. And then we use this uniplate transform function, so a generics library, just say, do that everywhere that you can. And I've written about 20 optimizations like this, so there'll be another one that throws away unneeded go-tos, and you just throw them through until you find a fixed point, and you end up often with very tight, concise, better than handwritten NSS queries. I should confess, optimizing the bytecode of your Azure is completely pointless. if it isn't outweighed by the files you're distributing, then you're doing something wrong. So, what did we steal from Haskell? Well, just like before, we have reasonable DSLs. In this case, we probably have a slightly nicer DSL, because we're working in the domain where Haskell has overloaded a lot of things for us. We've got phantom types to eliminate a lot of errors. So the types here really are key. So before we were working with very flex, everything is a string. Now we've got bools, ints, and strings. And you can't add ints, you can't add strings, you can't test on ints, all these things that are very nice. We can use the standard Haskell trick of define a library a module of primitives, then define modules that kind of wrap these primitives into safer, more pleasant things, and just keep working up the layers until you have something quite pleasant to use. So that's very nice. And that's the kind of thing where you're just not going to get in languages like Bash. We can pull on standard compiler techniques, because this is really a language problem. A lot of times, computer scientists will reduce something to a language problem before solving it. And we've got some more implementation, but not really necessary. And the result is that we're defining an installer using something someone else has already done all the hard work for, and we're just polishing up the edges we're seeing. It's kept all the good stuff and kind of all the bad stuff. Okay, so does anyone have any questions on NSS? We'll do proper questions at the end, but just if anyone's got any as they're coming up through. The slides also will be online at the end. Okay, so finally, on to Bake. So Bake is a continuous integration system. So if you think Travis, Jenkins, Buildbot, Hudson. So who here uses a continuous integration system? Okay. Yeah. They now should be kind of industry standard, I think. So Bake differs from other ones. In particular, you can never break the build with Bake. So I've heard tales of systems where when a failing test or a failing compile gets checked into the master branch, a big klaxon goes off, and all the developers start hurling rotten bananas at the developer who broke it. Various other penalties. In Bake, that just can't happen by design. So it's designed for teams that are large, so 5 to 50 people, kind of typical corporate-sized teams. Semi-trusted, so everyone's trusted to push into the main repo, more or less. I can do whatever I like, I'm trusted. I'm not going through pull requests or reviews. And productive. these people are sat there bashing out code and answering their emails and checking Reddit, but you know, bashing out code is at least a third of their day. So how do we actually do that? So for me as a developer using Bake, me here, me smiling because I'm using Bake rather than another continuous integration system. So every morning I pull from the master branch. I build my code, I do some development, run my tests, and I can guarantee that the master branch passes all the tests and compiles on all the platforms and has all the static guarantees we might define for it. I do my development on the Neil branch, so my own personal branch, check in my code, whatever, and when I decide I think the Neil branch should be merged onto the master branch, I don't merge it myself, I tell Bake to merge it for me. And what Bake does is it checks out the code, compiles it, tests it, run whatever verification I need, and then when it's finished, when it's happy that all my tests pass, it merges it into master. And just by adding that simple, you're not the one pushing into master, we guarantee that master is always perfect. And in particular, bad code is rejected. So it's also much easier for me as a developer. When I started in banking 5 years ago, if I pushed code that broke the build, I made it difficult for everyone. Lots of people were going to be giving me evil looks. So therefore, I compiled my code, compiled it on Linux, ran the test, and it took forever. Now, with Bake, I just fling it over the wall, and Bake is the one who does all the due diligence for me. I check my code works for me, check it does what I'm expecting, but I don't have to be the one to think about the collateral fallout of my code. Bake does that, and I'll test you that, and I don't get embarrassed when I get it wrong. So the other thing that Bake assumes is that there is not enough time in the day to test all your code. So we said, team of 5 to 50, so, and quite productive. So let's imagine that people are promoting code 50 times a day. And the compiling and testing takes maybe 10 hours, 2 platforms, an hour to compile, an hour to package, 3 hours for test. It's not unreasonable. But having 20 servers doing the testing seems infeasible, unless we kind of set it all up nicely with Amazon. And then it just seems expensive. So Bake's solution is to kind of merge patches together. So if two people can submit code at the same time, it will try and run the tests on their code combined. If that works, it doesn't need to prove that either patch individually worked, it just puts them together in the system. If a test fails, then it has to go about rejecting one or the other. I know some people would rather each patch was tested individually, but if you've got enough patches, that's just too expensive a proposition. So you can turn it into a mode where it will do that, but you need to back it up with hardware resources. And this is a screenshot. So after I've submitted it to Bake, I get emails when things happen, but I can also visit the dashboard, which will tell me what's going on. So Tony and Bob submitted some code this morning that got merged. Then Bob submitted twice and Tony submitted. Bob's second patch was rejected, so Linux from 10 failed. And now Bake is trying to check the remaining things. It's got 6 out of 10 here, 5 out of 10. And you've got multiple clients connecting to service jobs. And you won't be too surprised that you have to define the configuration of Bake in Haskell. So essentially, you can define the actions you'll build that must be checked on each commit. So we're going to say, well, we must compile and test it. And then we say, here, this is how you compile it, this is how you test it. And there's a little bit of dependencies, but nothing too much. This is a relatively simple configuration. So even for a kind of full production size thing, this is only about 50 lines of code, basically just enumerating your tests. And it's parameterizable, so in this case I've said, well, work with the Git repo on the master branch, so you can plug in your SVN, your CSV, whatever you like there, and you can change what tests there are, all kinds of things, how your email responds. And this is essentially the semantic model of Bake. So you've got a server in the middle, a single blast server. You've got the users, who are the developers sitting at the machine. They sometimes want to see the dashboard, and they sometimes want to send code for Bake to commit. And you've got potentially multiple clients who are just processes that sit there, probably on other machines, and ask the server for work and do the work on the server. So they run the tests for you. And then when you get to the server and the client, they shell out to something to prepare the build, check it all out, something to run the tests, query status about a patch, merge a patch back in. So if you look at all this, it's a lot of lines. Essentially, over each of these lines, some strings are flowing. In fact, many strings. So essentially, I've written a string movement system. And then if you see the star, this star is to indicate the clever bits. So there's one module in server called Brains. And that does something real, and thoughtful, and clever, and pure, of course. And then the rest is just strings. But because it's Haskell, we can do string passing properly, or slightly properly. Not as properly as, say, if we had session types, but it's OK. So we define a data structure that has a way to convert something to a string, and from a string, and then finally display it as a string for user consumption. And in particular, we want that these two functions, if you convert it to a string and from a string, you get back the same thing. And using Haskell, it's very easy to write a check function that takes a string and produces a new string, but every time you call string from or string to, it will do the round trip check. So now we can take in these round tripping functions, and if they ever go wrong, we can tell the user as soon as they've gone wrong in the right place with full information. So what have we stolen from Haskell? Well, it's parameterizable and configurable. You can change the version control system, all that kind of stuff. We're using types to safely pass around different strings. So there are many strings flowing around, and some of them are different types. And we don't get confused. That's something we know for sure. And it's always nice to be able to do a clever algorithm in the middle if you need it. But yeah, that's just almost detail. So Bake is only 6 weeks old at the moment, but it's also really going through internal prototyping. The workflow works. It just needs more RAM on the server. But it looks promising. We think this will be our next infrastructure project to move over to Haskell. So, I've kind of argued that you can do infrastructure in Haskell, and I've showed examples where we have. And hopefully that will kind of start to persuade you that, yeah, maybe Haskell is the right language, or your other statically typed functional language is the right language for writing your infrastructure code. And we've done it with Shake, NSS, and Bake. But there are other pieces of infrastructure that are still sat around as bash scripts, so there's more to do. And hopefully, because we're working in a functional language, we can all share whatever we do, so you don't have to re-implement a build system in Haskell. Thanks very much. Any questions?
Do you need to run one Bake instance per project?
Yes, probably.
When Bake does a test, let's say it's testing the nil branch that you're trying to merge to the master, does it test the tip of the nil branch, or does it actually make a commit that merges nil with the master?
So when you say promote, it takes the tip of the nil branch, but that's just using a local shell script. So yeah, it is a specific commit from the nil branch that it's trying to move in. And it doesn't test them on the nil branch, it tests them on the master branch merged with the nil branch,
okay,
with that commit of the nil branch.
How difficult do you imagine would it be to make Bake work with GitHub pull requests?
Should be configurable enough. I mean, so the whole notion of Git is optional. The thing is, it's probably not as... GitHub pull requests tend to be isolated units from untrusted people. So something like Travis is a perfectly good way of writing, of managing GitHub pull requests. And that's what I do even for Bake. Bake tests go to Travis. So it's you could work it, and you know, maybe in a few versions there'll be enough other compelling stuff about Bake that you want to go that way. But at the moment, I don't think it buys you much over Travis.
There's a Python script that Mozilla uses, Bake used before too. It's called Force, which works on top of BuildBot to do exactly what you're describing.
Cool.
So if you say that you kind of opportunistically try to test two patches at the same time, So if it fails, you then test them separately to determine which one passed the failure?
Yes, but in particular, in real life, your task, instead of having one test command, that would be like 150 individual tests you run. So one test will fail in the combination, and then you run just that one individual test on the two pieces. So usually that's not too expensive because you're identified what the bad bit is.
Unless, of course, you need both of them, like one
of
the other tests.
So after it's rejected one, it will recheck that. So it guarantees that the thing, the master, always passes, and yeah, it doesn't then have to rerun the test. But perhaps with other commits that come in since. So one nice thing about Make is, in advance, it will tell you there is a terminating sequence that will get to where you want to. Shake can't do that. In particular, it can't prove up front that your build will terminate. So it has to do dynamic checking of each rule to check that you're not recursing on the stack and various things like that. So there are advantages to replicative programming, which is you can get the whole graph out in advance, but you pay for it.
So I guess that also prevents Shake from having the drive run option as well?
In exactly the same way, yes. So Shake has an option to run without commands being actually executed, but it's not quite the same because you might actually look at the output of those commands to decide something.
I think that time is up. Thank you very much.
Thank you.